Thank you so much, Russ. Good morning to you. Welcome to our worship and a happy 4th of July weekend. It's a time when we thank God for this country that we get to share and for all those who give and gave themselves generously and selflessly for our freedoms. We want to welcome our guests today and invite you to please join us for coffee after this service. Thanks to many musicians and others who are helping us today. We thank Friends in Faith for their special music, and they are just loaded with good singers today. It's awesome. We thank also readers, ushers, greeters, Russ Bunker, our director of music. Thank you so much, Russ. We grieve today with several of our families because of some deaths. So Thursday, we said goodbye to Terry Knight, and we express our sympathy to his family. Terry was John and Marge's son, who died this past week. Michael Gillis, brother of Don Gillis, died Monday in Ada. Condolences to you, Don and Julie. Adam Mort, father of Brian Mort, died Friday, June 27th. We express our sympathy to Brian Connolly and all of your family. And Patty Bixler, sister to Kenny Nelson, died June 26th. And we express our sympathy to Kenny and Kim, Kurt and Gina, and all of their family. So many people affected by some deaths in our community. Well, we won't be outside today. That was quite a thunder boomer we had last night, wasn't it? But we do intend to bless animals at the very end of the second service. For some of you, I know some of you have coffee and then you run home and bring an animal or two, and you are most welcome. We're going to do it outside if the weather will permit us, out on the sidewalk, kind of at 11:45-ish. So if you came back, you would be most welcome to join us. And if not inside, we might have some dogs and cats inside at our service today. That would be appropriate. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. So Relay for Life is coming up next weekend. You'll see some action in the fellowship hall related to that. If you want to give gifts in honor of and memory of someone special, that's still possible. Ice Cream Social is coming up on July 17th. A lot of people have been very busy with that. And if you haven't been called, we still want you to participate. And I bet you could talk to Laurel or Kathy Nichols about that. Justice Journeys is providing caramel rolls today between services with a free will offering. You'll enjoy that. And I want to thank you for some time to be with my family this last week. And I thank Pastor Carl and other staff for stepping up in my absence. It's great to be back with all of you. So let's take a moment now as we prepare ourselves for our worship. Please stand as you are able for the brief order for confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Shall we pray together? God of gratitude, you have commanded us not to covet the things our neighbors possess. Help us to live not with envy, but with gratitude for all that you have given and provided for us. For the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen. You may be seated.
To the Lord, there's no place. get together with God's wonderful people.
What a sight just to see
all the happy faces.
Praising
God in heavenly places. What a thrill that I get when I get together with God's wonderful people. And there is plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold.
If you're lonely and looking for friendship,
if you're lost and want to be found,
there's
plenty of room in the family of God, and there's plenty of room to go around.
Yes,
there is plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold.
I think we have many kids here today, but we're going to include you anyway and include everyone. Today we're finishing up the Ten Commandments, and we're talking about coveting. Now, coveting isn't a word that we use a lot. It actually comes from Cupid, like cupidity, and it means that we love things. And it particularly means that we desire something that belongs to another, whether that would be something that they have, or it might be someone's spouse or some member of their family. But I'd like to come at that a little more positive way to talk about contentment. So do you know what that word means? Contentment? What do you think that means? Contentment. Satisfaction. So it means that we're satisfied with what we have. We're at peace with the things that we have in our life, the people that are in our life. And I think that has quite a bit to do with the size of our container. Okay? And that's kind of about expectations. So what do you think about that cup right there? It's pretty full, isn't it? To me, this is kind of a picture of contentment, that we kind of have a container, some expectations about what would be in our life, and we find that we're pretty full. Another word for contentment often would be enough, that I have enough food and clothes and shelter, friends. You think they were pretty happy about the friends that they have today? Good name, friends in faith, because they're pretty excited about all the friends they have in their life, as if their life is just really overflowing. Now, I'm probably not a real fan of advertising, because I think what advertising does is to say, okay, you got that simple phone. Get with it, people. you got to get a lot better phone. There's a new phone coming out. And I think all those kind of expectations, you're still driving a Chevy? Come on, if you were really with it, you'd have some European name on your faceplate. And all those things kind of make our container bigger. And so that the things that we have in our life, our friends and stuff. So how are we doing now? Pathetic. My life is just, it's only a third filled. Do I have enough? I don't have nearly enough. And so we can, you think it would max out my credit card to fill that up? Oh, yes, it certainly would. Contentment. So contentment is something that the Bible talks about quite a bit as a way to say there is a translation of Psalm 23 that I really, really like. It says, because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. Can you just repeat that after me? Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. That means enough, doesn't it? That basically means that if I kind of get my expectations around and realize that I am very grateful for what God has given me, that God fills my cup, and actually, Marlon's going to not like this very much, but there really is enough even in my cup to overflow for others. Was there anything to overflow for others in this one? It really wasn't. So that very often I think our prayer is that we could have realistic expectations and be very grateful for what we have. That, I think, is the secret to contentment. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. Let's pray. Lord God, this is hard because we are so bombarded by messages that say, you don't have enough, you need to get this, or you need to get that. Calm us down, Lord. Give us a bit of suspicion toward all those messages. They want to sell us something. And instead, help us to be content with what we have and even grateful that we have enough even to share. Amen. We're going to continue now with our lessons.
Today's Old Testament lesson is from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 17, a reading from Exodus. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I would invite you to stand for the gospel acclamation. The gospel lesson this morning is from the book of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 34 to 40, a reading from Matthew. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all of the law and the prophets." The word of the Lord. You may be seated.
It's not because we don't trust Reg as a reader, but our readings were pretty short today, weren't they? Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. When I was a kid, we had everything we needed. We ate well, we had warm clothes, good school, friends, and a loving extended family. But I didn't know it. My eyes were big, and I saw things I wanted. I wanted more, much more. I remember visiting my cousin Jim's house one Sunday afternoon. Now, Jim had something we didn't have at our own house, comic books. Hundreds and hundreds of comic books. The walls in his bedroom were stacked with hundreds of comic books. To be honest, it's the only reason we liked our cousin Jim, I'm sorry to say. And so that Sunday afternoon, after we quickly wolfed down our meal, and ditched my cousin Jim, I hate to say. We went to his room and just read comic books all afternoon. It was an exciting new world of Superman and Batman and all kinds of other superheroes. And I wanted my own comic books. But we didn't get an allowance, and there wasn't money for such things. But I still wanted my own comic book so badly. So can you imagine what I did that Sunday afternoon? At the end of that afternoon, I stole one of those comic books and hid it in my jacket. My desire for that comic book consumed me. I needed to have my own, even if I had to steal it. After all, Jim had so many comic books. He wouldn't even miss just one. It was very wrong for me to take something that belonged to my cousin Jim or anyone else. I don't even remember now what I did with the comic book I stole, which I think makes the second point. Actually, having it gave me no great pleasure. It was the desire to have it and the anticipation that was just overwhelming. That desire to have what belongs to another, we call coveting. And it's the subject of the 9th and 10th commandments. So this is now our fourth week talking about the 10 commandments. But if you remember, it all started with freedom. Freedom from slavery in Egypt, freedom for a new life in the promised land, where God's people could live out their lives with shalom, with peace and justice, just the opposite of what they had experienced in Egypt. But to live connected to God and peaceably with one another, we have learned that freedom needs boundaries and laws. The law of which the Ten Commandments is part is called by the Jewish people a fence. A fence around something they greatly value. Property, faithful relationship with a spouse, reputation. And so we've spoke about honoring God and our parents and not stealing, killing, or hurting our neighbor's reputation. So here we are in our fourth week, and it may seem unusual that we are spending this whole last day on the command not to covet. This is the only one of the Ten Commandments that is more or less repeated. You shall not covet your neighbor's house and physical property. You shall not covet your neighbor's spouse or the people close to them. It's also the only one of the commandments that's not really about our outward actions, but about inward thoughts and feelings. I think it's about our eyes and our heart. Different churches and our Jewish neighbors differ in making this just one commandment or two. And if you run into different lists, that you will see sometimes this is the ninth and tenth commandment, sometimes it's just the tenth commandment. Not all that important, I don't think. Because we all agree that many, perhaps even most sins start with coveting. When we set our eyes on something that belongs to another. Let me give you a couple of biblical examples. First, King David. If you remember him, one of our favorite superheroes of the Bible. He was hanging out on the roof one day, which apparently is what you do in the Middle East when it's pretty hot, when his eyes fell on Bathsheba, a beautiful woman that was already the wife of Uriah, a soldier in David's army. And suddenly he wanted her. So he took her. As the king, he was already married about 1,000 times. He had plenty of access to women in his palace, but he wanted Bathsheba too. And so he took her. And then when she turned up pregnant, he arranged for her husband Uriah and the entire military company of which he was the commander to be abandoned in the midst of a fierce battle. They all were killed. And it all started with a little coveting, that he wanted what belonged to another. I think it was the worst thing that King David ever did, and it started with a desire of his eyes. David paid a terrible price for his desire. It totally wrecked his family and really the rest of his life. Second story, King Ahab and Queen Jezebel. Probably the worst king and queen of Israel's history. Kind of a watchword of evil. They liked to garden. So they must not have really been that bad, huh? Or at least they liked to have a beautiful garden for their servants to take care of. And right near their palace, a good and faithful man named Naboth owned his vineyard. And I bet it was off their favorite balcony that here is this glaring piece of land that isn't theirs. First, they offered to buy the vineyard or swap the land for a better stretch of land, kind of out of the view of their balcony, I think. But Naboth refused. He said, "It's just like my little lamb, this piece of land." So Jezebel arranged for false charges to be brought against Naboth in court, and even paid two liars to testify falsely against Naboth. They were playing hardball. And in the end, Ahab and Jezebel got what they wanted. Naboth dead, and the vineyard as their own property. And it all started with a little coveting, and then the other commandments went down like dominoes. It all started with the desire of their eyes. And our eyes still get us in trouble, don't they? One of the greatest challenges of our day and of our faith is to deal with the desire of our eyes, with our overwhelming desire to have what we see with our eyes. It's especially serious, this commandment would say, if that desire will be at the expense of someone else. And yet our whole economy and society is built on creating desire. We have made desire itself the ethical standard. We are encouraged to say that greed is good, that desire is natural, and so we have to follow it. I fell in love. What could I do? I was helpless against it. Why is it that we buy and consume more than we need? God says it's an act of unfaith. God says in these commandments, don't desire the wrong thing, but instead desire the right thing, God. Certainly, we need to limit the damage that our desire does to our neighbor. I'd like to take just a step back from this desire of our eyes to unpack what coveting is about. First of all, the coveting assumes that we have a lack, something we don't have, but we really want and need. As if our container is not full to overflowing, but just a little bit sloshing around in the bottom. At least we convince ourselves we need it. I don't know why I thought I needed to have a comic book, because my life was really very full. And I don't know why I thought I needed to have it, even if it meant stealing from my cousin Jim. Oh yeah, cousin Jim. Certainly a second part of the coveting is that we think we are more important than our neighbor. That our desire and need somehow trumps or is greater than their need for what belongs to them. We may even feel, as I did, that it is our right to take it away from them. And that is when we move kind of from this commandment into the others, which is a very natural thing. It seems many of them start here at the tail end of the commandments and weasel their way into the rest. You've watched the detective show. It's either money or love that got us into this violence. Now, if this commandment is a fence to protect our neighbor from our desire, there are some gates in this fence that will open. It's not impenetrable. Gates that even God can open, wants to open for us. Not all desire is wrong. If we desire and are attracted to someone who is not attached to another, it is a God-given gift that we can pursue them, seek to get to know them, and perhaps marry them. There is no sin in such desire as long as this person could be available and is not already committed to another. And what about possessions? Is it wrong to desire anything? Is the fence totally closed? No, of course not. What is wrong is to desire something that belongs to our neighbor and then go about taking it from them by deceit or trickery. That is what this is clearly about. What is wrong is to neglect genuine needs of our family to obtain things that we don't need. What is wrong is to neglect sharing with others. Because there are truly some people, even right here in our own Purim and New York Mills and Frazee community, who really do have needs. There's an interesting study that was done some years ago asking a whole bunch of income levels, how are you doing? Do you have enough? Do you have 100% of what you need? Do you have too much? Are you 10% over? Are you 12% short? And so what do you think they found out when they asked all sorts of income levels about how they're doing? Everybody's 15% short. Everybody's 15% short. Even if you have billions, you're about 15% short, which is a lot of money. The thing is, the poorest of our neighbors who are 15% short, that's eating. That's going to bed at night hungry. So their being a little short is a little different than most of us being short. So first, we need to help those folks in real need. And a rule of thumb that Scripture uses, throughout the length of it really, is that if we give away a tithe or 10%, we don't need to feel guilty about buying things that give us pleasure with the 90%. That makes sense? Now, some of us can feel guilty about anything, but, you know, if we share with those in need so that they have enough, then we can feel more comfortable. Now, we are going to ask a few questions about that 90%. It's still a question, good question, why we want to buy something. Why do I need that? I think we can easily be manipulated by advertising that plays on our need to be wanted and special. Now, some would say, I need that car because I want to pick up some chicks. Okay? But often it's just, I will be a more special person if I can drive that Audi convertible. We are vulnerable to a pitch that says that if we would just use this shampoo, life would be so much better for us. Or drive this car, or have a big and special house, then we would be the somebody that we have dreamed of being. As if we need something to be good and human. We have made greed a high virtue. If we want it, go for it. And desire has become its own kind of bondage. It owns you. Not just the bills and debts, those can be kind of serious too, but the insatiable desire of our eyes that is never ending. This is where our faith in God is very important. Certainly, advertising plays on our fear that we are not enough and we don't have enough. We know that it's hard to be content that in God we have all that we need. I think of the translation of the 23rd Psalm that you repeated. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. And to be honest, that's my best mantra to repeat when I see something that I really, really desire. To say, because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. I was at a conference recently looking at challenges for our youth. Times have changed. It's not easy for us older people to kind of get our heads around how that works, to understand our kids and grandkids. When I was a kid, I was pretty sure that if I met someone and married them, that we could be happy for a lifetime. But we have seen so many marriages end in divorce and unhappiness that it's harder for our youth to believe that promise anymore. Is that surprising to you? And I thought that if I got a good education and I prepared myself, and if I got a good job, that I would be well taken care of for my lifetime. Is that true for you too? Did you kind of think that? But so many people have lost their jobs today that it's hard to promise, to believe that promise too. And so the promise of families and jobs isn't very dependable anymore. And so the speaker that I heard recently telling me about this said research shows that today our young people, you, find their fulfillment instead in buying things and in short-term intimacy. They say, I may not have a job or a family, but I'm going to get this new iPhone that comes out this month. And I've got some really cool jeans and shoes. And I have some great hookups. Therefore, I am somebody. I must be. And in this 4th of July weekend, we consider our freedoms, which is what these commandments are about. Freedom from slavery into a new life and promise. We consider our freedoms won for us in such costly ways by such great sacrifices. And we consider what our freedom means for us. The last few years, I've had good opportunities to meet and talk with a number of people from Eastern Europe who have left communism behind. That's certainly one of the grandest things that's happened in these last years. But I have often been disappointed that what they see as the dream of freedom is not so much democracy and self-determinism, self-determination, but they have watched television and they want the stuff that we have. A friend of mine jokes about his own coveting heart, "If they make it, I want it." And I told that to a friend recently and they said, "Only one?" And I'm afraid that is often what we show to the world as what we in America are about. Those things promise much, like my cousin Jim's comic book, and they do satisfy for about a minute. But that kind of desire, even briefly satisfied, does not lead to happiness or peace. The desires of our eyes and our hearts will lead us astray. Yet we are called to love God and to love neighbor. We are not to desire our neighbor's spouse or house. But do you know what? We can't do it. We can't resist this unbelievable pull. Yes, we can work on our resistance. I can say my mantra, "Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need." I can pray. I can try to serve others. But this pull of the desire of our eyes is very strong. We can't do it. This fence will not keep us out to live depending on and fulfilling the law. We thank God for this fence of the law that protects our neighbors from our coveting eyes and hearts, but we cannot fulfill it, not as we should. So whether it's this commandment or all the other commandments, when we come to the end of it, we say, "Thank you, God, for helping us with this fence that helps us to know how to live at peace with our neighbors. And Lord, I confess that I'm not doing very well with it. My neighbors suffer because of my greed and coveting." And so is with all the law. When we come to the end of the commandments, we throw ourselves on Jesus. And we are glad there is a New Testament as well as an Old. We cannot justify ourselves. And so we trust ourselves into the forgiveness and grace of our God, a freedom won by Jesus on the cross. Amen.
Thank you.
This time we move directly to the prayers. Let us pray. Lord God, we pray for safety and recovery for those hurt by high water right here in our area, for those touched by Hurricane Arthur on the Atlantic coast, for those in the path of Typhoon Noguri in the Pacific, including Dan and Lydia Dahl in Okinawa. Lord God, we pray for the Relay for Life coming up this weekend. We pray for safety. We pray for a good amount of money to be raised. Lord, we thank you for those who have survived cancer. We ask that you would be with those who are fighting that fight today, that you would give them victory, health, and recovery. Lord God, we pray for the family of Terry Knight, for the family of Michael Gillis, for the family of Adam Mort, for the family of Patty Bixler. Lord, we grieve the loss of these beloved ones, and we ask that you would give comfort and help to us. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. As members of God's household, I pray the peace of the Lord be with you always. Would you please stand and share the peace with one another? Take your time, and then we'll continue with the offering. This time, as we continue with communion, we want to know we have an open table for communion. You are invited to join us if you confess with us that Jesus is Lord. And we will kneel at the table today, starting here at the beginning, at the inside of the aisle, and then return our empty cups to the baskets on the way back to your seats. The ushers will direct you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God come for all is ready. Stand as you are able for the final blessing. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Let us pray. Lord God, they may have all the rest. Give us Jesus. Fill our cup with all that we need to live. And help us to live thankfully, generously, contentedly. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.